Hey everyone, my name's Abby and welcome to the Brown and Bougie podcast, where I'm keeping it raw, real and relatable. Hello, 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 and welcome back to another episode of the Brown and Bougie podcast. So as you can see, I've got a very special guest from across the pond from Canada. It's my absolute pleasure to introduce you to Prathi, who is the face behind the Instagram page Rubber Bride Reads. So I'm going to let her do her introduction as always, and then we can get into it.
Hi, everyone. My name is Prathi. I am from Toronto, and I run a Instagram page, like Abby mentioned, and it's called Rubber Bride Reads, where I actually document and curate books that I have really loved and enjoyed reading. With a particular focus actually on women of color. So it's this whole idea behind decolonizing your bookshelf, decolonizing your life, and really embracing our, I guess, more ethnic identities through reading different types of books by women of color in general.
Great.
It's really nice to hear.
Yeah, no, thank you for being here. It's my pleasure, to be honest. So it's really interesting because I really wanted to focus on the women of color, people of color concept, because I think everyone reads and we read random books, whatever we can find. We've been reading since we were very, very small. But what kind of attracted you to think, you know, I've got to focus, like, you know, I feel like a lot of brown Asian people anyway need to focus on that kind of books because we didn't grow up with that, right? We grew up with, you know, Roald Dahl and all these like white authors, I guess. So, you know, where was the thought process behind it, starting the page and things like that?
So I actually did, so eons ago, a little older than you, eons ago, I was in university and my actual degree was English. So I read a lot of books. So I focused actually on British literature, ironically enough. And as you know, British literature is very much a white space, a very white male space. Yeah. So at the time, I remember it was hilarious. Anytime there was a woman author, I would be so excited, thinking, okay, there's a new perspective. But what I was finding was that even the women authors I wasn't connecting with, there wasn't a perspective that was shared for me. So I started, you know, looking out for books that were written by different authors of different ethnic backgrounds. And half the time I'd have to ask friends for recommendations. So these aren't books that are typically recommended or really part of the curriculum when you're in school. So I would, you know, search out classes that are like, you know, South Asian literature, East Asian literature, and just different types of places around the world. And that's how I would get my fix, basically through word of mouth. And then when I really, you know, when I graduated from university and I could actually start reading for pleasure again, it was a choice between reading what was popular, because obviously what's out is what kind of dictates what's popular. So, you know, when books like Gone Girl come out, suddenly it's everyone's about thrillers with Girl in the title, right?
Yeah, it's like a hype. Yeah. It's like a hype, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So it was kind of like reading what's popular, but also my heart just lay in reading more intersectional types of stories. And I think that's what I started thinking, you know what, it'd be really great to create a page or an archive of these types of books. And what's funny is growing up, I would actually archive all the books I read, every single book, and I would give it a star rating out of 10.
Wow.
Right. And it was just a random thing that I did for years. So I literally have thousands of books that I've read. Mm-hmm. I read a lot. Just now that I have a child is harder, but you know, before I would read constantly. So for me, it was, I had this huge archive of books. So for me, it's, I already have the content. So what I do is I kind of go through it and I write these mini reviews, put it on my page. And for me, it's about creating a go-to place where people can literally just say, okay, I want to read something new, something different, hop on my page, and there it is. You know, you have a list of books to choose from. You just go to whichever one really interests you or sounds interesting to you. So just backtracking a little bit. Yeah, so after university, just reading for pleasure, that's when I realized I could kind of start choosing the type of books I wanted. So really decolonizing my reads and not just reading such one-sided perspectives. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of like a thing that I'm trying to do in my life, where I'm trying to explore, you know, the culture I already come from, you know, like, why do I not speak in Tamil more? Why do I not read books about Tamil people more? Like, it's weird. Like, it just, we become so assimilated that we forget that we have this rich culture that we're just completely, like, not really taking use of. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I think I completely agree. I think growing up, even for, I'm not a reader at all, but I think even, you know, the books that you were forced to read at school, they were all of white authors. And I think the one time, Noughts and Crosses by Mallory Backman, and I remember being like, whoa, this is so cool, like, this is like about a black man. I just remember, because all the other books were all about like slavery and black people, like, you know, it was like that and stuff. So yeah, I think it's definitely changed now, and I think the younger generation, I think, do have a lot more kind of choice in terms of what they want to read. They're a bit more like, what's the word? They're more like aware of, and they sort of, you know, they just are like, okay, cool, there are things out there for them and stuff. You mentioned your daughter. Do you think things have changed in terms of like the way, obviously we've talked about like it's changed how we were growing up and whatever it is, but do you focus a lot more with her about like trying to read books of culture and like, you know, things like that? Is that something that you focus on or?
Yeah. So my daughter's 18 months old. So she's a year and a half. So she's starting to now kind of really enjoy reading and, mm-hmm. you know, making sense of the world and putting pieces together.
Yeah.
So I consider myself an intersectional feminist, which means, okay. you know, I'm a feminist, but I take into account other intersectionalities that affect my identity. So my race, mm-hmm. My cultural background, those things make my life a little harder than, you know, just a white feminist, for example, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
So, you know, my fight is not the same. Our fight is not the same as certain other feminist fights, right? So for me, I wanted to be aware of our identity. So I actually drive 45 minutes out of my way to go to a brown doctor for her. Like I take these things very seriously. I make sure she sees women of color in positions of power, positions where, you know, I don't want to say positions of power, but positions of authority, you know, positions where they have a certain level of, you know, strength and responsibility. And I those things are important to me. So kind of books with different backgrounds, you know, I love to read books with all kinds of, you know, characters in them, different abilities, different races, different body types. Mm-hmm. And I want to normalize, if I'm going to use a very trendy word now, but I want to mm-hmm. normalize seeing all ethnicities, right? Like mm-hmm. all ethnicities, all sexualities, all gender. Like just for me, it's really important for her to see everything as normal and not, you know, the way we did, where I was like, oh my God, he's gay, or oh my God, like he's biracial. Like I want it to be normalized for her that when she, you know, I don't want her to grow up in the world that we did, essentially. So yeah, I do take these things very seriously. And I'm trying my best to make sure that she's exposed to as much as possible.
Fair enough. Yeah, no, I think that's great. Because I think, again, we grew up with this is right, this is wrong.
Yeah.
That's how we grew up. But actually, you know, everyone's right in their own way. And it's how you perceive it, right? Like, that completely makes sense. So it's really interesting looking at your page. Let's talk about that a bit more. I think there's a really big, you talked about specifically women of color or people of color, that's the authors that you go for. But I've noticed that there's a really big range in the types of books that you read, in terms of there's biographies on there. There's, I think you read Mindy Kaling's biography, and then, you know, there's like loads of different kind of a range. So where does that sort of start in terms of choosing a book for a week? And even how long does it take you? Because you post quite often, and like how often? It takes me like months to read a book sometimes. Like, but I guess if you're so passionate about it, it makes sense. But
well, the thing is, because I've been archiving it for so long, these books are not books I've necessarily read recently, right? There is a mix of books I've read recently, obviously. And these are books, like Mindy Kaling's book I read when it first came out, which was like, I guess like a decade ago at this point.
Yeah, it was a long time ago, yeah.
One of them anyways. So I like to read across different genres because I think that, for example, when you think of books by people of color, it's usually just in historical fiction, or it's just in regular fiction, contemporary fiction. You know, when have you ever found a book written by a Tamil author that's set in the fantasy world? Or like, when have you read a book that's like got a Tamil Sherlock Holmes? You know what I mean? Like, we don't get those genres ever. Yeah, and up until recently, it's always been struggle stories. And it's funny, you brought up slavery earlier, like, you know, the Black struggle.
Yeah.
And all, you know, any story that's about Black people always touches on that, which is, of course, important because it was a huge part of their history. And, it's the North American experience. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's like, it's nice to see Black joy. It's nice to see brown joy. It's nice to see romantic comedies. And we're trying to see more of that. We're trying to see more of, you know, just, you know, two brown teenagers falling in love. And their biggest struggle, yes, their parents don't want them dating. But it's like, that's relatable to us.
Yeah, everyone knows someone who's gone through that experience, right? Yeah, that's very true,
100%. And it's not so deep. And like, we deserve those stories. We deserve, I was making a joke to my friend the other day. I'm like, we deserve mediocrity at this point. We always have to be fantastic. We have to be the Beyonce of the music world to be taken seriously. Why can't we just be mediocre? Obviously I want us to be great. I don't wish mediocrity on anyone, but it's just, I think we were so used to reading such heavy, you know, excellently written, amazing literature, but sometimes it's just nice to have a little light YA book, or, you know, that's young adult fiction, or, you know, just like poetry. And I think it's like, not that poetry's like, but you know what I mean? Something that's like a different type of genre. And I think my goal for myself is just to read across, you know, different genres. So memoirs, poetry, plays, just anything. And I think that it's kind of impacts my reading experience too, depending on what I'm reading. So obviously when I read Michelle Obama's book, I was in that mindset to just be inspired and just really want to read someone, like read about someone who changes, you know, who's such a game changer, such a trailblazer. Yeah. But then on the flip side, you know, reading something that's more YA oriented, I think it's just, it's kind of like going back to your childhood and reading something a little lighter that's set in something, you know, set in school, and it's just not as heavy. Although it's still good. I think YA also gets such a bad rep, but it's improving quite a bit. And like the YA titles now are phenomenal. There's such a range. And I think there's such, and I think YA really picked up on the diversity thing first as well. So they have so many, you know, I see titles all the time with girls and, you know, wear hijabs, you know, people who are differently abled, biracial couples. And I think it's great because I think they're the ones that are picking up this diversity thing a lot more than adult fiction is, to be honest. So
That's where it should be, isn't it? I think that's what young adults should be, you know, talking about. And I think I've had this conversation with so many people that actually it starts from your roots, it starts from your childhood, and actually what is right and wrong, and you know, normalizing what is not seen as right, I guess, if that could make sense. But no, that completely makes sense. Yeah. So the one thing I wanted to ask was, I've seen that, you know, on your stories and stuff, you've posted things about movies and Netflix documentaries and things like that. Has there been any books that you've read? Because I know, I think, was it A Mistress of Spice? Is that the one with Aisha Ryan?
Mistress of Spice.
Yeah. So how did you find that? Because, you know, normally they say, like, even with Harry Potter, everyone said, oh, you know, all the people who read the books were like, oh, the films were so bad, they missed it out and they added this and whatever it is. Do you find that with the whole people of color thing, does that change quite drastically for you? Or do you come out being like, no, they didn't do it justice? Or
the thing is, reading a book and watching a movie or watching a TV show are two completely different mediums of storytelling. They both tell stories, but you have different tools at your disposal, right? Mm-hmm. So for me, I felt the movie and the book were pretty much on par, Mistress of Spices. I felt like they were pretty much on par. I can understand why the Harry Potter universe doesn't necessarily think the movies match up with the books, because there are 7 books.
Yeah.
A lot. And they're big books, right?
Yeah. I never got around to reading them. I couldn't. I was just going to watch a movie.
No, I mean, the books are really, really great. It's unfortunate J.K. Rowling came up with those transphobic comments. But anyways, the books are fantastic, right? And I think it's hard for a movie to match up. Maybe if they had made it a TV show and they had more time to explore. But then again, you have something like Game of Thrones that started off really strong and then they fizzled out near the end. Because I think sometimes pacing is also just as important, right? I mean, a book is a long-term investment. When I say that, it's like you have to sit down and you have to really, you know, take time to read a book.
Yeah.
Whereas with a cheap movie, it just feels like it's over in an hour or 2 hours. And it's like, of course, you're going to cut things out, right? Like you can go in with the same expectations. But I think if you treat it for what it is, it's a different medium of storytelling. Some of the movies were good. Some of the movies not so great. So I think it's hit or miss. And it's tough. It's a big story to tell. There's
It's pretty hard.
In terms of storytelling, I think if you're a reader, you're probably going to prefer books anyways. I think that's just a bias you're going to have regardless.
I mean, like, I'm definitely more of a movie person, so we can have this debate all day, because I'm more of a visual person. It's just how I learn, it's how I understand things, whatever. And yeah, actually, like, say, I've been trying to read a book for like 4 months now, and we've been in lockdown, I have nothing to do, and I still, like, I'm struggling to read it. It's just not something that goes in my head.
Are you reading this book because you think it's good or because you're genuinely enjoying it?
Because I think it's good.
That's what I'm saying. Here's the thing, right? Here's the thing. This is what I always tell people. People are like, oh, well, so you have an English degree and you like read a lot, so you must read like literature. I'm like, girl, no. Like the other, like in December, at the end of the year, I read a YA book about the K-pop industry. Like, I was just like, this is what I want to read and I'm going to read it. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if my professor saw me, they would have like fainted. Like it was just like a childish, silly book. But for me, it's like, read what you want to read. If that book's not doing it for you, let it go.
Yeah, it's just, I think growing up, just reading just never was my thing. Like my sister's like a proper bookworm. So she has a bookshelf of books. Like literally she sounds like you basically. But like for me, it's just reading was never, and I know my mum really forced me into reading. And because my mum forced me so much, I just began to dislike it. It was one of those weird situations. Do you know what I mean? So like now I'm like, I feel like I should get into reading rather than watch like Netflix series and stuff all day. So I was just trying to get myself into it, but I don't know, it's just not working for me. I shouldn't be saying this to you.
No, I get it. There's books that I can't finish because I'm like, I really want to like it. People have recommended it to me and I'm like, okay. Like I haven't read Great Expectations. Anna Karenina, I've tried a million times. I just can't get into it. And I don't want to get into it. Like, It's just sometimes just read what you want. I think it's like try reading something that sounds interesting. Like if the blurb doesn't sound interesting to you, don't read it. Like it's okay to judge a book by its cover, I think.
Yeah. Well, no, right? That's why I was, yeah, literally, I think that's what it is. And I was going to literally ask you about it. Like when you choose a book, right? So if I was going to go to a store, obviously now we have Kindles and everyone does eBooks and things like that. What is the first thing that you look at when you're looking at a book? Do you look at the cover? Do you flick a couple of pages and read a page? I don't know. What's the thought process when you're going to buy a book?
So typically, this is going to sound so crazy, but when I go shopping for books, there's in either one of two different states of mind. Okay. Number one, I know a book I want to buy. I will go in, I will grab it, then I'll just walk around and just peruse. And I already have the book in my hand, so I'm ready to go. Mm-hmm. But I'm kind of just going in to just peruse. I do look at covers. It's hard not to, right? Obviously, it's the first visual impact you get. I care very much about the blurb, and I care very much about, again, I think diversity just impacts everything I think about. So for me, if it's just another story with another white protagonist couple, it doesn't interest me as much as a story with, you know, a more diverse.
Yeah, it's sort of like been there, done. It's like a been there, done that. Yeah. Kind of, you know, that's the thing. You just, what's the point in doing picking up the same thing, basically?
100%. It's like the whole idea of decolonizing your life is you want, like, it's not, and then I don't just need to read Tamil authors because, you know, I am Tamil, so I don't need to just read about me. Like, I love reading about, I've really been getting into, like, Nigerian literature, like, anything that's set in Africa. Like, for me, it's just, I kind of just bounce around and I love learning about different customs. It just makes me feel like I can connect with people like that are not culturally the same as me, but we have similarities.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you're on TikTok, but recently the whole trend of fufu, I don't know if I'm saying it right, but you know, it looks so good. I want to try it. You're like, we're going to try it. So it's a West African staple. And it's funny to me because they eat with their hands, right? And I'm like, that's exactly what we do.
That's what we do.
Cultural similarity, you know what I mean? And then even like kind of backtracking back to when Never Have I Ever, the show with that Mindy Kaling produced with Maitri Ramakrishna, like when they were, the one scene that I think that touched me was when they were sitting on the dinner table, they're eating with their hands and they're talking about something, I forgot what it was, but they don't ever make reference to eating with their hands. They don't make fun of it. Yeah. It was just natural. It was just happening. And I'm like, yes, finally. And this is what I always say. There's media that's made for white people and there's media that's made for us. Mm-hmm. And I think this was made for us because there was no mention of it. It was just natural. Like, why do we need to explain it to you? You understand. And that's the first time I think I really felt seen in media, and I felt seen in like something that I've never been seen in before. And I think that's important. And that's what connects with me when it's something is literally made for us. It's like, finally, it's like, it's our turn to like feel seen and feel represented. You know, I want to see the Tamil like detective, like kicking ass. I want to see like Tamil horror. Like, how cool would that be? You know what I mean? Like,
exactly.
Like, I want to see our version of things. And I think that there's so much talent out there. And I think hopefully we'll start to see more of that. And I think.
Yeah, I think it's definitely getting better. It's definitely getting better. But at what rate? We don't know, but it's getting better, you know, generally. So, that's the thing. I think the next generation, and I think that's what I always focus on, because I always think that when it gets to a point of when I have a child, I don't want my kid to go through that stuff because, you know, every single brown person in some way was treated differently, teased, bullied, you know, just because we are who we are kind of thing, you know, and you know, it shouldn't be that way at all. So yeah, I think honestly, like the fact that like even with Never Have I Ever, like talking about it, literally, like you said, it just felt so normal. It just felt like, oh, I was just watching something that was happening in my house, like, you know, praying to God before I go to school about like really petty things when I was a teenager.
Exactly.
Like all that stuff. Yeah. I was like, we've all done it. Like
we've all done it. And even like mother daughter relationship felt so authentic. Like obviously a lot of it was greatly exaggerated with the mom's accent and stuff. But and the show's not without its problems for sure. But I think that it's such a great starting point. So I'm hoping in season two they'll kind of, you know, go more into her life, but and stay away from like the very court. Like, I mean, there's some problematic elements. We don't need to get into that. But
yeah, of course.
On the whole, I did like the fact that it was geared to us, which is something that you never get to see ever.
Yeah. So what I wanted to ask was, so if someone who is not really a reader wants to get into this sort of, I don't want to call it a genre, but like, you know, the space of reading people of color, women of color, is there like a top three books that you would definitely recommend that, you know, you thought were great? Because your ratings are really helpful. I find them quite really interesting and stuff, because I think that sometimes you can tell like, oh, it's not as strong as the thing from the rating. But is there like a top three that you would recommend, like top three books of all time that someone should read?
There's the one book that I do recommend when people ask, you know, what's a good book for Tamil people to read? The one that I do recommend a lot is The Boat People by Sharon Bala.
Okay.
That one is set in Canada. It's set in Sri Lanka a little bit. And it is on my page. It's called The Boat People by Sharon Bala. I don't know if I said that clearly, but that's a really good one. You know what? We're talking about YA earlier. One I would suggest is The Hate U Give by Angie Thomas. So that actually came out as a movie. I don't know if you remember. With Amanda, I think her last name is Stenberg.
Okay.
I believe it was her. Anyways, it's a really good book and it's a good movie. So it's one of those things you can read the book.
I might take you up on that.
And they're both equally amazing. And The Hate U Give, you know, I think you would actually love The Hate U Give. I think it's because it's a YA book.
Okay.
So it's a little bit more accessible. So I think YA books, the only difference is that they're just a little bit more accessible. They're not so highfalutin sometimes. And it's not as, in my opinion, it's not as pretentious, right? I think it's just they're really well-written, strong stories for the most part. And I think The Hate U Give would be good. And in terms of another great book would be Dominicana by Angie Cruz. I don't know if these are necessarily my top three, but right now those are the three that are popping up in my head.
Yeah.
Dominicana by Angie Cruz is a very strong immigrant story. And I think that's something that I related to. So it's, you know, a child bride actually comes over to New York from Dominicana and goes through this experience of like culture shock and just having to like assimilate, which is something I think we can all relate to.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Or our parents can definitely relate to, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it stuck with me because the writing is so simple, but here's my thing. Writing doesn't have to be very fancy, very elevated. I think as long as it has a strong message and the author has a mastery over the story, you know, you're not letting the writing take over the story. You're letting the story take over, right? And I think that's kind of what you like really nailed down in this. The story is really good. And it's my favorite kinds of books are the ones that are very readable, very accessible, and you can kind of understand the story and feel the story instead of like trying to sit there and trying to figure out the language, right? Like when the language just starts getting in the way and you're like, what am I even reading? Like, what was the sentence? And going back and rereading it. I think that's what a lot of people struggle with because they reread the same sentence. They're like, what? So I think it's better to just read books that you think sound interesting. So those three are the books I would recommend, but there's just so many. It's hard for me to nail it down. You know, when you read as much as I do, it's like me asking you, what are your favorite three songs, right? Like you probably have favorite songs, but then you're like, wait, did I forget one? I don't know.
No, that's fair.
If you're looking for, you know, if you want to kind of maybe mix up your reading list a little bit and just try different genres of books and just explore different cultures, definitely stop by my channel, my Instagram page. I don't know why I thought I was a YouTuber right now. Stop on my Instagram.
Are you thinking about it? You could definitely do it. You know, like
not with a laptop obsessed toddler. No way. You can stop on my Instagram page. It's Robert Bride Reads. And it's like lots of mini reviews of really great books. And I do want to mention that I do not post books that I did not enjoy because that's not what that page is for. It's not a journey of my reading. It's the books that I think, for whatever reason, are good reads, and you'll see why in the mini reviews. So stop by.
Great. Fantastic. Well, thank you for your time. I do appreciate it. You've taught me a lot because, again, I'm not a reader. So, you know, I came across your page and I was like, whoa, this is really interesting. Because, again, I've never come across, I've seen so many book pages, but none that focus on one kind of type of author, I guess, and stuff. But I love that. I love the range, which is really, really good. So, everyone, check her out. Her stuff is amazing. So yes. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time and it's been a pleasure. And that's pretty much it.
So as of today's recording, my last post on my page is actually about Mariah Carey's book, which is really good, by the way. Again, I think you'd like it, Abby. So I picked Fantasy by Mariah Carey. It's just one of my favorite songs. It's such a feel-good song. It's just, I mean, I don't listen to music when I read, but I could listen to that and read. You know what I mean?
Fair enough. Yeah.
That's my, what is it? Today?
It's a tune of the day, but today it works as well. It's like people just say it's a sound, and I'm like, basically, I'm just trying to be cool. But there you go.
Thanks again for listening. If you enjoyed this episode, don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe. To catch all the latest from me, you can follow me on Instagram at the Brown and Bougie Podcast. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time.